My name is Peter de Menocal. I'm the 11th president and director of the Woods Hole Oceanographic Institution. And I think each of us can remember that moment when COVID-19 showed up at our doorsteps, forever changing and disrupting our lives. For me, I was in a good place. I was just completing my 30th year at Columbia University as a professor of earth and environmental sciences. And I was looking forward to sabbatical. I just finished a term as dean of science. I was looking forward to getting in shape and digging back into my research. I had a contract for a book. I was really primed to be productive. But then on March 12th of 2020, and I think each of you can sort of remember that day, my life took an unexpected turn. By chance, I happened to bump into a friend of mine who worked in the School of Public Health at Columbia. And he said, the novel coronavirus has arrived in New York. It's not looking good in the hospitals. I give it maybe 24 hours as your window of opportunity to either stay in the city and hunker down or move out, go somewhere else. And so I raced home and grabbed my wife and my two children. I threw a whole bunch of clothes in the back of the car and we drove north. We have a house in the Berkshires of Western Massachusetts and went up there. And as we were crossing, the George Washington Bridge, I remember looking back at the bridge and saying, you know, this is really going to be an incredible time. We're going to spend time together as a family. But little did I know that was going to be the last time that I would return to New York. My years as a climate researcher really coincided with a revolution in climate science. Back when I was a graduate student in the 90s, it was really hard to discern a global warming trend from just the general noise in climate, the natural variability in climate. But fast forward to today, it's unequivocal that the rises in temperature and the climate fingerprints that we see across the planet are due to rising greenhouse gas emissions. I got an interesting call when I was up at our house in the Berkshires. It was a call from a headhunter asking if I'd be interested in becoming the next director of the Woods Hole Oceanographic. And, you know, I mean, the Woods Hole is legendary. It is the leading independent ocean science institution in the world. It's 1,000, about 1,100 employees of scientists and engineers and ships and submarines. Just this incredible opportunity. And so when I think about the climate system, one really thinks about the oceans. The oceans are fundamental to the climate system. And so this is really intriguing. I realize this is a blessing of sorts. And it was an invitation really to meet the moment, to address the climate challenge. We live on an ocean planet, and everything that we care about, food, water, shelter, crop yields, climate stability, greenhouse gas concentrations, all of these things depend on the ocean. So meeting the moment, for me, required a small act of courage. And that act of courage was to give up tenure at Columbia University, to give up my position there, to leave my friends and my colleagues for decades, and to move to the Woods Hole Oceanographic. But it would be really open up a new opportunity for me to pursue the biggest of big ideas with this team at Woods Hole. It's an amazing team of scientists and engineers, and we're going to pursue these biggest of big ideas, and I'm going to share one of these ideas with you today. So one of the most sobering moments in my professional career has been understanding the role of the oceans in carbon dioxide removal. All pathways that limit warming to 1.5 degrees centigrade require carbon dioxide removal. This is a quote from the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, the AR6 report. And you know, why this statement is so compelling is that it said, we've run out of time. We've tried to decarbonize. We've tried to slow emissions growth. It's just not enough. We now have to actively take carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere and at the scale at which, and even greater than, we're putting it into the atmosphere. And so this is a really tall order. It's actually a bit of a fairy tale because there's not a single technology that can scale even close to this at the moment. So a helpful way to think about this is actually from a colleague of mine, another fellow oceanographer, Dr. David Ho at the University of Hawaii. And he thinks of it as a way back time machine, carbon dioxide removal. That is, if we have some way to remove carbon from the atmosphere, it sets us back in time, almost like back to the future, to some time of lower carbon dioxide concentrations. But it's also a way for us to appreciate the magnitude of the carbon dioxide challenge. So for example, you may have heard about this idea of using direct air capture to capture carbon dioxide from the atmosphere, liquefy it, and store it underground. This is a plant in Iceland, and the Wayback Time Machine sets us back a whopping 3 seconds. The idea to plant 100 million trees anywhere in the world, but 100 million trees, that's like the American West. 100 million trees sets us back a half an hour. It gives you an idea of the scope of the problem. It's a very effective tool. So now we fast forward to the oceans. We live on an ocean planet. The ocean is vast. It covers 70% of the planet. The ocean is a climate hero. It absorbs 90% of the heating from excess greenhouse gases, and it absorbs 25% of carbon dioxide in the surface of the ocean. This occurs because as we burn fossil fuels and emit it to the atmosphere, it increases the partial pressure of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, and it pushes down like a piston on the surface of the ocean. So this, what's called the solubility pump, with waves crashing and bubbles bursting, the ocean is this gigantic carbonated beverage, and the carbon dioxide is being pushed into it over time. So just with the ocean's natural ability to take up carbon, it's giving us a Wayback Time Machine of 3 months. It's a clue. The oceans are tremendously important. And just to focus on just how important it can be, during the last ice age, the carbon dioxide levels were about 100 parts per million, or about a third lower than they are during the pre-industrial time. We've now learned that that carbon was stored in the oceans. Just to put it in context, that 100 part per million, a natural thing the ocean can do to take up carbon, is worth 60 years. In other words, that Wayback Time Machine could send us back 60 years for the ocean's natural ability to take up carbon. So how carbon gets into the ocean, one is the solubility pump that we talked about. The other is called the biologic pump, which is exactly what you think it is. Photosynthesis and light in the sunlit portions of the ocean with nutrients generates this abundance of life in the surface of the ocean. That fixes carbon from the ocean, sustains the chain of life in the sunlit portions of the ocean. And then a fraction of that organic matter rains down through the water column. And as it rains down through the water column, it runs through what's called the mesopelagic layer, which is between 200 meters and 1,000 meters in the ocean, sometimes called the ocean twilight zone. The ocean twilight zone is this incredible area of biologic activity. 95% of all fish in the sea are there, and we can't see it. What's incredible about the ocean twilight zone, and actually this is a research project that is funded at the Woods Hole Oceanographic, as a result of a TED talk. It was actually a TED Audacious Prize. And we were awarded this prize to study the ocean twilight zone because it is the carbon pump that pumps carbon from the surface down to the deep ocean. When it gets down to the deep ocean below about a half a mile, it's durably stored for a century, even millennia, because the waters there are so slow moving, that's how long it takes for them to communicate with the atmosphere. So the ocean twilight zone has this daily migration. It's actually the largest animal migration on the planet. And fish like the lanternfish, if you know them, they're about the size of my finger, and there's just billions, trillions of them. It's an entire fishery that's hidden from view. This is what big-eye tuna go after. This is what swordfish go after. This is the mesopelagic is this carbon pump, and for the purposes of this presentation, is a carbon pump sending carbon down to the deep ocean. So as we look to ways in which the ocean, we can use these natural processes in the ocean to explore carbon dioxide removal approaches or technologies, the National Academy of Sciences in 2001 released a study that looked at ocean-based solutions involving CDR. And they looked at six different approaches. I'm just going to focus on the top three at the moment. But these are ways in which you can use natural processes, augment them to encourage the ocean or to allow the ocean to take up carbon at scale as it does naturally. One of the approaches is what's called iron fertilization. This is not dumping iron filings into the ocean. This is actually using soluble iron. And we've known for decades that if we put just a tiny bit of iron in a flask with seawater and algae, that the algae will grow much faster and be more productive and stimulates productivity. And the ratio is something like 1,000 to 10,000 to 1, so you get this tremendous bloom of productivity from iron fertilization. Another one is called alkalinity management. The reason why the ocean has so much carbon in it, has 50 times more carbon in the ocean than there is in the atmosphere, is because the ocean is slightly basic. It has a pH of around 8.1. And so by increasing the alkalinity of the surface ocean, you can actually make the ocean a natural chemical sponge. And this is what the Mississippi River does. A third way is dead simple, which is you grow a lot of kelp and you bale it up and sink it to the seafloor. But the first thing that's most important is that we can't be advocates for ocean CDR. We have to be advocates for understanding the basic science that would then pin carbon dioxide removal technologies to determine, does it work? Does it cause harm to the ocean? Is it durable? And is it cost effective? Right now, we are flying blind in the ocean. We have no sensors in the ocean that tell us about this process other than some pogo-sticking floats that are called Argo. There's about 4,000 of them in the ocean, one for roughly every state of Texas in the ocean. They are measuring some properties, but not carbon and pH and the things that we need to understand the carbon system. So if the ocean stopped functioning today, we would never know it. If the ocean was being affected by the warming of the ocean or overfishing, and it adversely affected ocean health, we would never know it. And so we are introducing this concept of building an internet for the ocean. The whole idea of building an internet for the ocean is to build an always-on, always-connected ocean internet of sensors that are talking to each other, much in the way our phones would be talking to each other, sharing data, saying, I was just here, I measured this, go back there and search, record that, and then go to this station, download the data, get more power, and go do another mission. Right now, we have to send ships out that go out for a couple of weeks to a couple of months. Very expensive, very slow, and doesn't give you the time and space coverage that you need. So we call this the Ocean Vital Signs Network. And really what this allows us to do is to sense the interior of the ocean. We are envisioning this as a system that's unprecedented in size. It's 1,000 kilometers by 1,000 kilometers square, so 1 million square kilometers, twice the size of Texas or twice the size of France, depending on how you think of this. It's an enormous space, and then the full ocean volume. And the idea is to understand how ocean health and ocean carbon flows and stocks are changing not only over time, but also in response to these perturbations. The key motivation for this, for anybody who works in this space, is to measure, report, and verify carbon flows. It makes no sense at all to pursue CDR if you can't prove that it works. And this Ocean Vital Signs Network, this internet of the ocean, allows us to do that, as shown by this example here. The left would be at a control, and on the right would be an enhanced biologic pump example. Right now, we can't discern between these. We don't even have any idea if this would be happening today in today's ocean. This technology, this Ocean Vital Signs Network, allows us to do that. So what might this look like? Well, I commissioned 12 of our leading scientists and engineers to explore the white spaces of this problem. What are the leading technologies that we need? What are the big ideas that we need? What are the enabling technologies that we need? And they came to me with a white paper at the end of about a 6-month period and sketched this idea whereby it's an armada of undersea drones that have new power management and new communications technologies using acoustics, so we communicate very effectively with acoustics. Below the ocean, you don't have electromagnetic radiation because the ocean is salty, it's conductive, and so electromagnetic radiation doesn't work undersea. But you can use acoustics, and then we can use blue lasers. Blue lasers have a long distance, and you can actually use the optics to get very high data transmission rates. And so the idea would be at these crosses are places where the robots can dock. We can do that. Places where they can go in, dock, and repower. We can do that. They can go there and they can download their data, clear their buffers, and go out for another mission. We are doing that. What we're not doing is building this right now. This is an idea that is so exciting. I just got back from COP a couple of days ago in Egypt in Sharm el-Sheikh, and this is an opportunity. In fact, this is what we were discussing there at the Ocean Pavilion, the first time there's an Ocean Pavilion at any COP in history. One of the reasons we went there was to build these partnerships, not only between national agencies across this country, but also across international ocean research agencies and corporations and philanthropies. And that's really what this is about, is partnership to really lead a new era in ocean observations. We live on an ocean planet, so it should come as no surprise that understanding the oceans is going to be key for ocean solutions or for climate solutions. We have a responsibility, in my opinion, to meet this moment. Indeed, that's why I'm here. We have a responsibility and an opportunity to revolutionize our understanding of the oceans and to drive new understanding that's going to help us lead these solutions. But I'd like to end where I began. A measure of courage is required, not only from individuals, but in the larger partnership of research organizations, of governments, of the private sector, and of, importantly, for philanthropy, providing risk capital. We can work together to work to accelerate the urgent search for climate solutions. Thank you.